Hey, it's Nathan, and today I wanted to go ahead and talk about all of this stuff, the goal of which is to introduce a particular mathematical constant that has to do with some fundamental thing behind the number one. So, in particular, there are a lot of mathematical constants out there that answer some fundamental question about the structure of math, and there are the more popular ones that are more accessible, like pi and e, but you could easily just go to the Mathematical Constants Wikipedia page and begin reading about and finding resources on a whole slew of them. The constant that I want to talk about today actually doesn't appear on that list, and it has to do with how many different ways you can write the number one. As some motivation, one of the things that we care about in mathematics is we care about understanding the structure of different mathematical objects. And one of the bigger tools for doing that is figuring out how to express different objects in different ways. And so this can be done across the board from elementary mathematics to higher math, where we go ahead and take certain numbers or computations or structures and express them as other numbers, computations, or structures. One of the more powerful representations that comes up across mathematical fields is that of different power series representations. And so it can be natural to ask about how many different ways can you express a particular value or a particular function or a particular thing in terms of a relevant power series representation. When it comes to representing numbers, one of the relevant power series is that of different base expansions. And so since we're focused on the number one in this video, we can ask about how many different ways can you express one with a given base expansion. So when we ask this question for n a positive integer, the answer is actually pretty boring. We can only express one way with these base n expansions. The relevant expansion is going to be point n minus 1 repeating for any given n greater than or equal to 2. The classic example of this is that, well, 0.9 repeating is equal to 1, and you can use various different methods to prove that is the case. The one that's relevant here is that 0.9 repeating is just a particular geometric series, and we have a formula for geometric series that tells us how to evaluate them, and of course, when you go ahead and plug in that stuff into that formula, you end up getting 1. In order to make this problem a little bit more interesting, one could ask, well, can you do the same thing but just with zeros and ones? If we're still stuck on the positive integers, the answer is yes, but we can only do it with one positive integer, 2. And I've gone ahead and written out a short proof of why that would be the case in the case of the base being 2 here on the board. However, when writing 1 with just zeros and ones, we don't need to just think about a positive integer base expansion of the number 1. We can in fact do this for any number in between 1 and 2, including 2. Any such expansion in base q of the number 1, using just the numbers 0 and 1 in the digits of the expansion, is called a q-development of 1. We already saw on the previous board that when q is equal to 2, there's exactly one q-development. However, when you restrict your attention to q being strictly between 1 and 2, more interesting stuff happens. So when you're between 1 and 2, it turns out that there are two different algorithms that we can go ahead and use to generate a q-development that's possibly non-unique. So in a greedy algorithm, what we do is we try to take as much as possible. So in this particular case, we'll be taking as much of a portion of 1 as we can in each part of the sum without exceeding 1. So we'll start our expansion with a 1, and then for everything after that first number in the expansion, we'll see if we can get away with taking a 1 in that position or not. If we can, that means that the sum up until that point plus the thing that we're deciding on is going to still be less than or equal to 1, and if we can't, then that means that we will have exceeded 1 if we used that place as a 1. On the total opposite side of the spectrum is a lazy algorithm. So in general, in a lazy algorithm, you do the least amount of work possible to achieve your goal while still forcing yourself to achieve it. So what happens in a lazy algorithm for this particular case is you see if you can get away with leaving that term in the sequence out of the series sum. And if you can, then you just have it as zero. And if you can't get to one without it, then you force yourself to pick it up along the way. Since when we're using these algorithms, Q is between 1 and 2 strictly, so it's not hard to imagine that a given Q development from a greedy algorithm and a given Q development from a lazy algorithm expansion are distinct. And that's because when you look at the geometric series with 1 over Q as the first term and 1 over Q as the common ratio, that geometric series is going to converge to something that is always greater than 1. And so by definition of convergence, you will always be able to replace an infinite number of ones with zeros and still converge to something greater than one. So it's not hard to believe that there are a lot of cases of Q where Q has multiple Q developments. For some examples of some expansions with these algorithms, we can go ahead and look at Q equal to 4 over 3. In the greedy base 4 over 3 expansion of 1, we end up with 0.10001 and so forth, according to the calculation. In the lazy base 4 over 3 expansion, we get 0.0001 and so forth, according to the calculation of the algorithm. So this illustrates that it is possible to get different Q developments of 1. And if we return back to the Q equal 2 case, we also know that there are some Q out there where you get exactly 1 Q development, or you get exactly 1 way of expressing 1 with zeros and 1s. And so because there exist numbers out there, like 2, where you get exactly 1 Q development, or 1 way of expressing 1 with zeros and 1s, you can go ahead and ask the question, well, what's the smallest number where 1 has a unique expansion? In 1998, Vilmos Komornik and Paolo Loreti answered this question, and one of the major tools that they used when they answered this question was a relationship between Q that give unique Q developments and the digits in those unique Q developments and how they're related by order, or particularly how those sequences of digits are related by a lexicographical order, and then further how the greedy algorithm relates a particular choice of Q to those particular sequences of digits. The lexicographical ordering works just like a dictionary does. We say that 0 is a smaller symbol than 1, and so one sequence is less than another with respect to the lexicographical ordering if, in the first place that they disagree, the lesser sequence has a 0 and the greater sequence has a 1. In particular, the greedy algorithm is a order-preserving onto map, or a orders preserving bijection, that respects order between the set of numbers that give a single Q development ordered with the usual less than, and the set of a particular type of sequences of zeros and ones, which we'll call admissable sequences of zeros and ones, ordered with the lexicographic ordering. The order preserving part can be motivated from a pretty intuitive standpoint. If A is less than B, both give unique Q developments, then the series for A will approach 1 faster than the series of B will, since 1 over A is bigger than 1 over B, and we're using the greedy algorithm, so we're taking as large of a part of 1 as we can at each step of constructing these particular developments of 1. Note that the comparison of 1 over A being bigger than 1 over B also holds for powers of 1 over A and 1 over B. So the first time that the series for A has a 0, the corresponding B term may be small enough as to not exceed 1. Or in other words, if this was not the case, one of the powers of 1 over B would be strictly greater than the corresponding 1 over A terms, which would be a contradiction. The onto part takes a little bit more work. I've gone ahead and left some references down below because I'm not going to be able to go through the entire proof in this video, but it's actually a result of the one and only Paul Erdős and a few other mathematicians, namely Komornik, the same guy that this particular constant is named after, and Yoho, who I don't have any other mathematical context for. So the sequences themselves that are being mapped onto are a bit easier to describe than the onto argument itself. We say that a sequence is admissible if and only if the sequence is lexicographically greater than the n truncation of the conjugate sequence when the nth position is a 1 or is lexicographically greater than the n truncation of the sequence when the nth position is a 0. The nth truncation is just the sequence starting at the n plus 1th term, while the conjugate sequence is the one where you change all of the zeros to ones and all of the ones to zeros. For example, the sequence of all ones is admissible, and the greedy algorithm maps 2 to the sequence of all ones. So the constant at the heart of this video comes from the fact that Komornik and Loreti were able to show that there is a smallest admissible sequence, and then because the greedy algorithm produces an order-preserving bijection between these two sets, there is a smallest q with a unique q development. Now this q is called the Komornik-Loreti constant. So the smallest particular sequence that they found turned out to be the 2 Mohr sequence, which I've written a few terms out on the board here, but I could talk about it for days. There's a ton of really cool things about the 2 Mohr sequence. I've also linked some information about it in the description below because I think it's a very, very cool thing. With a smallest admissible sequence, one can conclude that there is a smallest number q sub kl, which is the Komornik-Loreti constant, which is given by the value 1.78723165O, and so forth. There's a ton of other stuff about this constant that's really cool, like it's a transcendental number, and I've gone ahead and linked some resources to those results as well down below. And I think that gets us to basically everything I wanted to talk about today. As a note, I have started doing some Twitch streams around the math that I think about and stuff in more depth than what I do here on the YouTube channel, because I'm getting to the part of my program where I'm not doing a lot of homework and exam-based work, and I'm doing more of the reading and digesting of material in order to get ready for research part of this process. And so it just felt like a sustainable way to, one, hold myself accountable in those areas, and two, still share some of the math stuff that I think about in a more consistent manner. So I'll be hanging out on there. Currently it's Mondays and Thursdays, but I still haven't heard about what my work assignment is for this semester, which is crazy because it starts in a few days as of recording. So schedule is may flicker a little bit, but it's basically set in stone for now. Otherwise, yeah, if you enjoyed this video, give it a thumbs up and subscribe for more math stuff that I do on the internet here. I've got more math videos. I also talk about my PhD experience and how that's going. Again, it's probably popped up there at some point through the video as well. So if you're interested in those, you can click up there or they're in the description below. As always, I am Nathan. This one was Chalk, and I will see you next time.